see everybody this morning. We're going to be singing today out of the celebrational hymnal. Celebrational hymnal. So if you get your celebrational hymnal out, let's all stand as we sing this morning. Hymn number 12. Hymn number 12.
Morning. I'd like to welcome you into your Father's house. It's good to be able to come together. It's good to see you here this morning. I hope you understand that it's good to be seen. If you're joining us at a different time or from a different place through some medium, we also want to welcome you. We want to invite you to come and be with us physically in person here, 9:30 on Sunday mornings for worship. It's good to be able to gather in our Father's house. Again, welcome.
Thank you, Brother Wayne. We're going to get back into a service and song this morning, and our hymn this morning is 329. There's Power in the Blood. 329.
Power in the blood. There is power, power, one.
Our next hymn is hymn number 302. It's called Lamb of God, 302. Shelly, have you got one of those great messages ready for the young lady this morning that might be talked into coming down here this morning? You want to come down this morning?
I've got one, but I didn't figure she didn't want to come by herself.
She said sure. You can't beat that young lady right there, I'm telling you. This time we're going to have our children's message.
Holding Gracie, a toothbrush. You probably had never thought about a toothbrush having a message for you, but it does. The Reverend Mr. Toothbrush says one of my duties is to help your appearance. Pretty clean white teeth will add to the appearance of anyone, and our first appearance is very important. The toothbrush helps to protect your teeth. By cleaning them daily, you prevent cavities from starting. It is not much pleasure to sit back in a dentist chair and have the dentist pull a tooth. This often is not necessary if the teeth are properly cared for. Not only will the brush help preserve your teeth, but it will protect your general health. This tells of a man that had been in poor health for many months, and the doctor thought that he had cancer of the stomach and put him in the hospital, saying he would not live over 2 or 3 more months. That was 45 years ago, and he is still living. The doctors in the hospital said his teeth were poisoning his entire body. They extracted them, and he was soon back to work. For the brush to help, it must be used. So that brush hadn't helped anybody, has it? Because you can tell it hadn't been used. It is of no value on the holder on the wall. It's like safety belts. They will not protect unless they're buckled around you. That same law that applies to the toothbrush are applicable to our spiritual life. Christianity blesses us when we apply the Christian principles to our daily lives. And that's much like the Bible. If it's sitting on the shelf gathering dust, doesn't do much for you. But if you use it and apply it like we use and apply a toothbrush, it can make all the difference in your life. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the lessons that are all around us, even in something as simple as a toothbrush. Remind us daily, Lord, that we need your word and your presence to live our lives the way you want us to. In Jesus' holy name I pray. Amen.
Couldn't do without y'all, I promise you that. At this time, for ushers will come or receive this morning's regular offering, and that'll be followed by our building fund offering this morning.
Portion to give.
asked you to remain standing. Our praise song is going to be in the overhead this morning. And, of course, we're going to do the song this morning, Holy Ground. And we'll do that before we turn it over to Brother Wayne for this morning's message. Once again, the name of the song is called Holy Ground. Beautiful song. At this time, we're going to turn it over to Brother Wayne for this morning's message.
This thing of holy ground is a little bit tricky. I've been in churches with other folks, preachers primarily, who would really, really chastise children for playing on the kneeling rail, which they call the altar. This is the altar. That's the kneeling rail. That rail's there to help you get back up. The inference was that somehow by those children playing on it, it somehow was sacrilegious or it desecrated the holiness of it. I want you to really listen and understand things that are holy are not holy by your doing. And because of that, you cannot make them not holy.
You can be disrespectful or whatever, but you didn't make them holy. You can't make them not holy. They are made holy by one greater than you and I. We come into this place, it's our Father's house. We should come in here just like we come to our home. All our folds, bruises, bumps, scratches, we should come asking. A lot of times people leave and feel whatever, disappointed. I always think they are disappointed because they came not prepared to receive what they might have needed. Because they came unprepared, they probably didn't even recognize it when it was offered, and so they left without it. It's kind of like the folks was sitting around, and after Sunday morning, you know, they were sitting at the lunch table and eating, and they're just tearing up. You know, the choir was awful, the preacher was awful, on and on and on. Everything was awful, 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 awful. And one of the little children sitting at the table said, well, I thought it was a pretty good show for $2. If you have your Bibles, we're going to look at John, the first chapter. We're going to begin reading at verse 29. We're going to read through 42. I believe it's 42. As you are able, would you please stand for the reading of the gospel? I'll be reading today from a New International Version of the Bible, John chapter 1, verses 29 through 42. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel. Then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me. The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God. The next day, John was there again with two of his disciples. When he saw Jesus passing by, he said, look, the Lamb of God. When the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. Turning around, Jesus saw them following and asked, what do you want? They said, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Come, he replied, and you will see. So they went and saw where he was staying and spent that day with him. It was about the 10th hour. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, we have found the Messiah, that is, the Christ, and he brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, you're Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which when translated is Peter. My friends, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. How many of you have ever heard Jesus referred to as the Lamb of God? It often seems like kind of a common way to talk about Jesus. We hear it, we sing about it. But in the Bible, this is the only chapter in the Bible. The writer of John is the only one that uses that terminology. The Lamb of God. We can think about it as someone meek and mild. or we can think about it as one that's blood will be shed for the sins of others. But what does it mean? What does it mean? I think about the toothbrush in the package. I think about the dread of going to the dentist. I think one thing that we don't think about very much in this life is being shut off from love. I'm not talking about you don't have a girlfriend or a boyfriend or a husband or a wife. I'm talking about shut off from love. There is no one who cares for you. See, that's what hell is. The Bible uses a lot of terminology, and some of it's fantastic, and it's fantastic on purpose to help you understand how terrible it's going to be separated from God. Now, this Lamb of God came that we might have the opportunity for that not to be the case in our life, that we might have the opportunity. It gets back to that toothbrush. That toothbrush. It's hard to make little children understand the need to brush their teeth. They've never been to the dentist. They've never had a toothache. Once those things begin to happen, it's a little easier. However, once those things begin to happen, it's a little bit too late. Decay and cavities, pain, sufferings on the way. Toothbrushes will help, but the inevitable's coming. The Lamb of God is not that type of situation. He comes to take away our sins and to deliver us unto life. But it is exactly like that toothbrush. As long as that toothbrush stays in that package, it's not going to do a single bit of good. We have to open the package and actually make it a part of our life regularly. It's the same way with the blood of the Lamb. But we've lived, most of us, a long time, some longer than others. And we've lived in an environment, we've lived in a world, we've lived in a creation that has fallen. We don't concentrate much on that. I don't believe that we give it much of a thought. Everything out here is not the way it should be, except for a few hearts that have received the blood of the Lamb. Everything else is against you. It's against nature. It's against God's creation. It's against the way it should be. Over time, that begins to wear us down, even though we're not conscious of it. Over time, we begin to accept what it's trying to preach to us, teach to us, impress upon us, mold us into, that we are under its power and there's nothing that can change that. That there is no blood of the Lamb. It's a nice story. I want to call your attention to Isaiah 49, first 7 verses. Everybody kind of recognizes Isaiah pretty easy as a prophet. Most people kind of like Isaiah's writings. I like them. I want to read it to you. Great prophet, no doubt about that. But I want you to listen to this. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my birth, He has made mention of my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. In the shadow of His hand, He hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, you are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor. But I said, I have labored to no purpose. I have spent my strength in vain and for nothing. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God. And now the Lord says, he who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength, he says, it is too small a thing for you to be my servant to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth. This is what the Lord says, the Redeemer and Holy One of Israel. To him who was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers. I want you to listen to this. Just as surely as God knew, as God called, as he formed, as he had a purpose for Isaiah, so you and I. Kings will see you and rise up. Princes will see and bow down because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. All of this is made possible because of Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, the one who saves, because he is the Lamb of God. Now we can continue to trudge along and exist here with the world pushing and pulling and molding and shaping and tearing at the very fabric of our lives. Or we can stop that. Now I want you to think about the gospel. Here is John the Baptizer. He's got disciples, followers, people who are trying to be like him, trying to learn from him, trying to mold and shape their lives. Good people serving a good purpose. But when they are introduced to the Lamb of God, they turn and follow him. It's not enough to be a good purpose seeking a good person seeking a good purpose. There is a greater purpose. And there's a greater person that God wants you to be. Do you hear what Isaiah said that God said? Isaiah is a prophet. He's speaking God's word to God's people. As surely as the people who heard him then were God's people, so you and I are. Kings, regardless of what the world has said to you, tried to teach you, tried to mold and shape you into understanding who you are. Kings, when they see you, will stand up in reverence. Princes will bow down. Why? Because of the Lamb of God. When you are covered in his blood, you participate in his life. And his life is true life. We're early in this year. How are you going to spend it? How are you going to exhaust yourselves in existence? In helplessness? In despair? Get your bulletin. Pick it up. Look at it, the back of it. Look at those names. You know those folks. God has called you by name. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth. That starts right here. You can't jump from here to the end of the earth. It has to start where you are. If you hear the words of the writer of John's gospel, if you hear the words of Isaiah, you cannot deny that you are called by name, that you are equipped. Why? Because the blood of the Lamb has been shed and you've been introduced to Him. Are you going to take advantage of the opportunity? Or are you going to let the world continue to beat you up to take your life? I think about Ralph a lot. He's a big boy. He can handle it. Can you imagine losing your sight? He's got a smile every morning. Every Sunday morning I see him, he's got a smile. That's not accidental, and that's not natural. Our nature is not bent towards God. It's bent towards the world. The world's going to take from you. It's going to tear at you. It's what the world does. But God came that you could be delivered from the world into life today, not way off sometime when you cease to have a heartbeat. But today, right now, in the midst of whatever's going on, now you can leave here hopeless, helpless, like so many of us do so often. But if you do, go look in the mirror and blame yourself. Don't blame God. Don't blame the church. Don't blame your church family. Don't blame me. I got plenty of blame. I don't need any more. Blame yourself, because that blood was shed even for you. And you have been introduced to the Lamb of God. The decision is yours. Stuff's going to continue to happen. You can be delivered from it or owned by it. But what Isaiah was prophesying has come to be through the blood of the Lamb of God. And the decision is yours. The decision is yours. The world can't control that decision. You have that power. Please choose God. Please do it today. Because Ralph may need something to smile about tomorrow. And God's called you into His life, into my life, into our lives. He's here and He's smiling. How's your life? I love the Dr. Phil. You know, how's that working out for you? God offers you life in the midst of whatever's going on. Choose it. Let us pray. Father, we thank You for the day. We thank You for the gospel. We thank You for those who came foretelling of the Messiah, the Christ. We thank You for those who wrote these words that we might hear them and know. Father, if there are any struggling today, I pray that Your Spirit would well up in them and give them the courage to accept the Lamb of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take our hymn books and turn to our closing hymn, 426. 426. If you'd like to come and pray, I encourage you to do that. If you'd like someone to pray with you, if you'd lift a hand, some of us will. Otherwise, we're not going to bother you. If you need to make a decision, please don't be deceived into thinking that I'm just not quite ready. I'll do that another day. No, you chose. You just didn't choose God. Please choose life. Choose God. The Lamb has come through your life. Follow Him. Let's stand as we sing. 426. Peace, may the grace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit go with you always. Amen.